Braja Janarandana.
Spiritual master opened my eyes with the torchlight of knowledge. I offer my respectful obeisance at the lotus feet of my spiritual master. Vande aham Sri Guru Sri Yuta Pada Kamalam Sri Gurun Vaishnavanuscha Sri Rupam Sagrajatam Saranaravunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagan Lalita Shri Vishakhan Mitamscha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dheena Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanda Radha Kanda Namostude Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavane Swari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye
Vanchakalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyavacha Paritanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadara Srivastadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
In the Bhagavad Gita, in the 16th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, when you look at the verses 1 to 3, there is a list of 26 qualities by Shri Krishna. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, he says, can everybody have a copy of the Gita or open it up on your phone? Because we'll read this verse together. Verses 1 to 3. We'll just read the Sanskrit and the English translation, and we will then look at one specific phrase in that in those three verses, and the class is based on those that phrase. Okay, so 16, chapter 16. The first three verses of chapter 16. Okay. Everybody has it open? 16? Someone who has the hard cover, it's page number 615. And someone who has the soft cover, please indicate the page number. Someone who has a soft cover.
615.
That is for hard cover. And someone who has a soft cover, please indicate the page number. Chapter 16. 577 for the soft cover version holders. And for the phone holders, it's right on your phone screen. Okay. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 Shri Bhagavan Uvacha.
Shri Bhagavan Uvacha.
Abhayam Sattva Samshuddhi.
Abhayam Sattva Samshuddhi.
Jnana Yoga Vyavasthitihi.
Jnana Yoga Vyavasthitihi.
Danam Damascha Yajnascha.
Danam Damascha Yajnascha.
Svadhyaya Stapa Arjavam.
Svadhyaya Stapa Arjavam.
Ahimsa Satyam Akrodha.
Ahimsa Satyam Akrodha.
Tyaga Shantir Apaishunam.
Tyaga Shanti Apishunam.
Daya Bhuteshva Loluktvam.
Daya Bhuteshva Loluktvam.
Mardavam Hira Chapalam.
Mardavam Hira Chapalam.
Tejakshama Dhriti Shaucham.
Tejakshama Dhriti Shaucham.
Adroho Nati Manita.
Adroho Nati Manita.
Bhavanti Sampadam Daivim.
Bhavanti Sampadam Daivim.
Abhijatasya Bharata.
Abhijatasya Bharata.
Please also repeat the English translation by Srila Prabhupada. The Supreme Personality of God had said,
the Supreme Personality of God has said,
fearlessness,
fearlessness,
purification of one's existence,
purification of one existence,
cultivation of spiritual knowledge,
cultivation of spiritual knowledge,
charity,
charity,
self-control,
self-control,
performance of sacrifice,
performance of sacrifice,
study of the Vedas,
study of the Vedas,
austerity,
austerity,
simplicity,
simplicity,
non-violence,
non-violence,
truthfulness,
truthfulness,
freedom from anger,
freedom from anger,
renunciation,
renunciation,
tranquility,
tranquility,
aversion to fault finding,
aversion to fault finding,
compassion for all living entities,
compassion for all living entities,
freedom from covetousness,
freedom from covetousness,
cleanliness,
cleanliness,
and freedom from envy,
and from the passion for honor,
passion for honor. These transcendental qualities,
these transcendental qualities,
O son of Bharata,
O son of Bharata,
belong to godly men,
belong to godly men,
endowed with divine nature,
endowed with divine nature.
So Prabhupada uses the phrase godly men, but applies to all godly souls. Okay, so we are specifically going to focus on, there's a specific phrase
in the second verse of this chapter, in the second part of the verse, it's called Dayabhuteshu. Okay? Dayabhuteshu, which is compassion for all living entities. That's what we are going to focus on. Compassion for all living entities. We are looking at, today we'll look at four examples. There are countless examples of Vaishnava compassion, but we're going to look at four examples of Vaishnava compassion from various traditions, including our own. And then we will look at what compassion is and what it is not. Right? And then where we can start, and if we have already started, then where we can continue, how we can continue. Okay, that's what we're going to look at today. Okay? The first example is a very famous example in the Western world. It's the example given by Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati and Srila Prabhupada as examples of, as an example, as a primary example, shining example of Vaishnava compassion. And that is Lord Jesus Christ. Very famous in the Western world. You know, he forgave the people who were trying to kill him. Obviously, no, he knew that nobody could be killed or nobody could kill him, but he still forgave someone who was trying to do this act. It's a very difficult thing. Even someone does a slight injustice to us, we hold it against them forever. So somebody who is trying to kill your body, it's very difficult to forgive them and have that kind of compassion towards them. He preached God consciousness in a part of the world where God consciousness was practically non-existent, and wherever it was existent, it was just a show. Like, it was a kind of farce that was going on there. And he knew that he would be persecuted for trying to preach God consciousness in this area of the Middle East. But he still did it. Sacrificed his life. He was a young man, you know, 32 years old. And he still sacrificed his life, you know, knowing that this would happen. You know, Prahlad Maharaj is a great example in this regard. He's a Vaishnava Acharya. He is mentioned in the Vedic scriptures, in the Bhavishya Purana, as a great saint. He is also mentioned in many other scriptures, including the yoga texts. He's also mentioned in various temple records in certain parts of northern India as having come there and studied the Vedic scriptures with the other scholars who were there, and then went back to his land to try and teach this to his dense people. He had 3 years to do his job. 3 years was all his mission lasted. And then, you know, he realized that, you know, whatever he could teach was as much as he could teach them. He could not teach them anymore. So he also gave shelter to people who are accepting his instructions and offered to accept all their sinful activity. We don't even want to accept our own sinful activity. We want to pass it on to somebody else. Not my fault. Wasn't me. Somebody else. Right? But Jesus Christ agreed to accept that. Now, he's very well known in the Western world. But we should understand from the Vaishnava tradition that there are millions like Jesus Christ. Millions. Okay? They think that he's the only one. But we know that he is one among a long line of many great souls who have come and will come in the future also. It's an endless stream, not just one Jesus Christ, there are millions of Jesus Christs in the Vaishnava tradition. The greatest example that comes to mind when we're talking about our specific tradition, our Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition, is a close associate of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu named Vasudeva Datta. For Lord Jesus Christ and many other souls, it is required to take shelter of their instructions in order for them to accept responsibility for your sinful actions. But for Vasudeva Datta, he was so immersed in compassion for all the living entities that when he came in front of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and asked for a benediction, he says, "Can you do me a favor? You know, I can't bear to see the sufferings of all the living entities in this universe," he said. "You know, can you please release them from all their sinful reactions?" And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the moment he heard this request, his heart melted and tears came to his eyes. You know, to see the compassion of this soul, who is a, you know, Vasudeva Datta is also appearing as one of the sakhas in the Vrindavan pastimes of Sri Krishna. So he always travels with the Lord. So he was completely moved by this request. And he says, sure, you know, if you desire this, it will happen because Krishna is not incapable of doing this. And Vasudeva Datta said, if you think that there is so much karmic reaction, so much sinful activity that all these people have already committed, then you give it all to me and I will stay here and suffer on their behalf and you can release them into the spiritual world. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu embodied the Bhagavad Gita verse saying that Nadatya Kasyachit Papam Nachaiva Sukritam Vibhu. Krishna says in that the Lord does not like to give someone's sinful reaction to somebody else. It's a very fair system. He does not like to do that. He can take away the sinful reactions, but it's not like he's somehow limited that he has to place all these sinful reactions in the lap of somebody else. So he said, no, Krishna would not like for you to suffer on other people's behalf. But since you are desiring it, you can take it that Krishna has already liberated all the living entities from this universe. So this universe is very blessed by the presence of Vasudeva Datta, that all the living entities are already liberated. It's just a matter of time and realization by which they can attain to that. They are unnecessarily dreaming around here in this universe. This is a very special universe, okay? So this is quoted in the Madhya Leela. If you look at the 15th chapter of the Madhya Leela, there are many verses that talk about this. In the Adi Leela also it's mentioned, in the 10th chapter of the Adi Leela, verse number 42. And then Madhya Leela chapter 15, you can read this exchange from verse 160 onwards. So it's not just Jesus Christ who manifested this kind of Vaishnava compassion. Another example from another Vaishnava tradition, we have four main Vaishnava traditions, four bona fide, I would say, Vaishnava tradition. There are many branches and sub-branches of those traditions, is Sri Ramanujacharya. He's a great Acharya from the Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya. And he also manifested this Vaishnava compassion in many different ways. His whole life is a, if you study Ramanujacharya's life, it's a study in compassion. But one specific incident, okay? So when he was still a student, he wanted to get a particular mantra from his Acharya who was in Tirukottiyur. Tirukottiyur is a place where there's a nice temple of Lord Vishnu and this particular Acharya, Tirukottiyur Nambi, was also known as Goshtipurna. He was very famous, you know, at this time. And Ramanujacharya wanted to get this mantra from his guru, from his Acharya. By the way, Ramanujacharya had many gurus for different purposes. So just like us. So he wanted to go. So he went there and it was not like he could just hop on a bus or a train and go from wherever he was in Kanchipuram to Tirukottiyur. He had to walk. It's about 100 kilometer distance, okay? He had to walk 100 kilometers to go there. And the first time he went there, his guru said, no, come back some other time. Okay, so he went back. Okay, he offered his obeisances to his guru, went back, walked 100 kilometers back again, okay? He went the second time, guru said, no, not yet, come back again. Went a third time, a fourth time, fifth time, sixth time, 17 times Ramanujacharya walked 100 plus kilometers one way, right, to receive this mantra from his guru, and 17 times he was refused by his Acharya. And he didn't say, oh, it's been taking too long for this initiation, I shall find another spiritual master. He went there an 18th time, okay, and the 18th time his guru sat him down, you know, gave him the instruction of the mantra. The mantra comes with a bunch of context, you know, it's not just the mantra, but there's a lot of context around the mantra. So he gave him the full context, explained to him the importance of this mantra, the result of what happens to someone who chants this mantra. And he said, never give this to someone who is materially attached. Give this to somebody who is really interested in transcendence, you know. Don't give this to anybody, in other words. Right? Unless somebody is as dedicated as you are to this mantra. So Ramanujacharya came out from this initiation session from his spiritual master. He carefully considered the whole situation. And then he climbed up on the tower of the Tirukottiyur Vishnu temple. And he says, all of you, people of Tirukottiyur, I have a priceless jewel for you. People are interested in jewels. So they came. What is Ramanuja going to give us? They came. They all gathered under this Gopura. And then Ramanujacharya said, I will repeat a particular mantra. Anybody who chants this mantra will go to Sri Vaikuntha right away. So, will you do it? They said yes. And then he chanted the mantra three times. He initiated the whole crowd, thousands of people. And he said, pass this on to everybody you meet. Like our Acharya says, chant Hare Krishna, tell everyone you meet. Right? So, they were overjoyed. All the people chanted this mantra. By the way, we don't chant this mantra because it has not been received by us in disciplic succession. And parampara vihina, ye mantra chite, nishpala mantra. We don't just chant mantras willy-nilly that we find around. But he instructed them in the mantra, Om Namo Narayanaya. This mantra is chanted by the Sri Vaishnavas to this day. Goshti Purna, his acharya, heard about this. Right away, right? Like it was very quick. He was in the same town. He didn't even go to another town to do this activity. And he says, do you understand the consequences of disobeying the instructions of your acharya? He says, yes, Guru Maharaj, I understand what is the consequence. What is the consequence? It means that I shall have to go to hell. So he says, you are willing to go to hell? Yes, but all those people will go to Sri Vaikuntha. Who have learned the mantra and who are going to teach it to the others. So, in fact, it shows the compassion of Ramanujacharya. His guru embraced him because he understood the depth of his compassion. And he got the title M. Purvanar at that time. So it's an amazing example of Vaishnava compassion, right? The most famous example and the most accessible example to us is our own Srila Prabhupada. So Srila Prabhupada, His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, in 1977, was enacting his departure pastime. He was going. He was leaving us. So the disciples were very eager to protect the health of their spiritual master. So they were bringing vaidya after vaidya, doctor after doctor. Prabhupada would refuse. He refused to take the Western medication. He only wanted to take Ayurvedic medication. So the Prabhupada, they used to bring, you know, teacher after the doctor after doctor, and Prabhupada would try sometimes the remedies, sometimes he would not try, sometimes he would take it for some time, sometimes he would not take it for some time. Because Prabhupada knew what is happening here. So he was just humoring and entertaining his disciples at this point. But once one of the vaidyas came as an astrologer. Who studied Srila Prabhupada's chart and studied the whole situation very carefully. And he said, you know what? I know why Prabhupada is so ill. He said, it is because, sir, you have allowed the installation of your deity form in various temples around the world where you are still present in your human form. So whenever an acharya deity form is installed in a particular temple, then people offer obeisances like just we did, you know, they offer flowers, they touch the lotus feet of the deity, we just of the deity form of the acharya. When this happens, their sinful reactions get deposited into the form of the acharya. And because the acharya is still there in the physical form, he's not taking on this directly, but all of those sinful reactions are flowing through him continuously. Even those who are not surrendered, by the way. So, when a disciple accepts diksha or initiation from a spiritual master, the spiritual master acts as a conduit for their karmic reactions and it goes back to Krishna. You know, sometimes spiritual masters get sick, sometimes they get bad dreams, etc. due to the sinful reactions of their disciples. But in this particular case, there is no requirement for initiation in this particular case, right? Everybody is basically doing that. And so the acharya said, immediately remove the deity forms of yourself from all of these temples. You will become in good health again, immediately. Srila Prabhupada was listening to this person patiently. At this point, he lost his patience and he said to his disciples, does he not know for what reason I have come here? Right? So it's a very recent example, happened in 1977. Does he not know? I'm actually here to take on everybody's pain and relieve them from all their miseries. So these are very lofty examples. You know, if we are in the hospital and if we are sick, somebody tells us, do this and you will feel better again, we will immediately do that. Especially if this is being caused by somebody else, right? We may or may not be able to manifest that kind of compassion. Okay? It's very lofty. So, looking at these four examples of Jesus Christ, Vasudeva Datta, Ramanujacharya and Shri Prabhupada, one might get discouraged and think, I'm never going to be able to get this Vaishnava compassion thing. I don't know what this is. And it's out of reach for me. But actually, our scriptures reassure us that we should not be discouraged by, you know, there is hope for all. But it starts from understanding what is compassion and what is not. Okay. Now, I'll take the most obvious example of what is not compassion. Okay. This is a German word. There are different languages for different things. There's a particular German word which expresses what is not compassion in a most ideal way. It's a word called Schadenfreude. Schade means something bad has happened. And Freude means joy. So literally the dictionary meaning of Schadenfreude is to take joy upon others' misfortune. Or to become happy and gleeful to hear of somebody else's pain. Literally this means, okay? So first and foremost, this Schadenfreude should be avoided in our lives. Unfortunately though, our whole civilization is built on the back of Schadenfreude. Ever watched a sports game? It's the definition of Schadenfreude. Millions of people cheering for one team, millions of people cheering for another team. One team makes one mistake, and the people who are supporting the team that has made a mistake, identifying with them, you know, go, and then everybody goes, yay! Right? The perfect example of Schadenfreude. You know, our whole world is based on that. But it's not limited to this. This business is based on Schadenfreude. Put the other people out of business. Right? That's the purpose of it. A whole material civilization is based on envy. You know, kill that person so that I can eat his flesh and I can be happy. Destroy that one. Later, there will be a time for questions. Right? So, destroy this person. When I say person, I'm taking the Vedic idea of person. Animals are also persons because they are spirit souls. Birds are persons, they are spirit souls. Our whole civilization is based on this. Right? All forms of competition. Like ever written a competitive exam and got a certain rank, right? To get admission into some university or some, you know, some or get a particular job or something like that, right? That is Schadenfreude too, because you know you have to beat everybody else in order to make that happen. So even though it seems very obvious to us that we should avoid this kind of thing, actually our whole civilization is built on it, on top of it. It comes into devotional service also. I distributed more books than that person, right? I know more verses than anybody else in this room. Right? Like all of these are very dangerous forms of lack of compassion. Advanced Vaishnavas never feel like that. And if we are feeling like that, even if we may not disclose it externally, we have to know that we haven't made it to the level of Vaishnava compassion yet. Okay? But there are less obvious examples of lack of compassion. Okay? So some of them, for example, I'll give you three examples. Like I have noted down three examples. Take, for example, a small child, like this child sitting here and that child was just here and that child sitting in the lap, right? Take that child as one example. Another example is a sick person, a person who is experiencing some tremendous illness and is on a very strict diet, okay? And the third example is someone who does not know what is good for themselves. Okay, three kinds of examples. Okay, now if you give that sick person, the child is throwing a tantrum. It's time for them to go to bed or take a nap or have a meal or whatever it might be that the child doesn't know needs to be done. And the parent is being very strict with that child and saying, you better get in line here and lie down here, put your head on this pillow and close your eyes right now. Okay, sometimes parents can do that. Okay, or you eat this right now. Here is a spoon. Stop. Right? It happens. Right? It's the parent's responsibility to keep the child alive. Now if some stranger intervenes and says, Mataji, Prabhu, why are you being so unkind to this child? That person is a dead person. Right? It's not compassion. Right? It's not compassion to speak like that to the parent of a child. Because the parent knows what is best for their child. When the child needs to sleep, the child needs to sleep. Right now, when the child needs to do the homework, the child needs to do the homework. There's no two ways about it. right? A sick person who is given some kind of very unpalatable food to aid their recovery. You go and sneak them samosas. They will die, right? That person will be finished, right? It's not compassion to give them rich food, proper food, especially today is Ekadashi. Right? Now the third kind of person is, let's say you find a person on the street, bum on the street, you give them 10 bucks. They don't know how to use that money. They don't know what is good for themselves. They're going to use it to harm themselves.
Yeah.
Right? So that is also not compassion. Srila, Shri Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that there are charity in three modes. There's charity in the mode of goodness, charity in the mode of passion, charity in the mode of ignorance. And whenever we do charity in the mode of passion or ignorance, that is not compassion. Charity in the mode of goodness is compassion. So there are many nuances, right? How to be compassionate, right? First of all, we should understand that our material world is built on lack of compassion. So therefore, the fact that we are in the material world means we are by definition we have no compassion. In order to survive, you have to kill your compassion to some extent, right? The advanced Vaishnavas like Sanatana Goswami, who had insect like worms on his body, and the worms were falling down, and he was saying, "Hey, this is your food." Putting it back on his body, we'll be like, "Where's the antibiotics? Kill these things." Right? So Sanatana Goswami is at another level. We are at another level. Where do we start? Okay, where does it start? Where do we start to, first of all, Vaishnava compassion, charity begins at home. Vaishnava compassion starts by actually being compassionate with ourselves. And how to be compassionate with ourselves? Right? How to be compassionate with ourselves is, I'll give you an example, okay? So, there is a particular metaphor used in the Vedic scriptures. It's in the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. It's a very famous verse, okay? We don't have enough copies of the Srimad Bhagavatam to go around, right? But I will just maybe chant this verse once and everybody can say it with me, just so you remember it. Right? Many people might already know this verse, okay? It goes, Nivritta Tarshair,
Nivritta Tarshair,
Upagiyamana,
Upagiyamana,
Bhavaushadar,
Bhavaushadar,
Shrotra,
Shrotra,
Manobhirama,
Manobhirama,
Uttama Shloka,
Uttama Shloka,
Ka Uttama Shloka,
Ka Uttama Shloka,
Gunanuvada,
Gunanuvada,
Puman Virajeta,
Puman Virajeta,
Puman Virajeta,
Puman Virajeta,
Vina Pashugna,
Vina Pashugna.
It's a very famous verse. Okay, in this, there is a particular verse called Tarshair. Tarshair. I will find out. I don't have it noted down here because it's one of. I can give it. Sudarshan Prabhu is going to find out the verse number and let us know in a moment. Okay? 100%. And we'll talk about that in a moment. Okay? So, Tarshair is a particular form, Sanskrit form of the word Trishna. Trishna means thirst. Trishna refers to a kind of thirst that cannot be quenched in the place where you're trying to quench it. Specifically, it is also used in the Bhagavatam in the sense of Mriga Trishna, which means the hopeless thirst of the animal who is destined to die. Okay, so we see it in Canada also in the summer, but we see it in hot places more often. Which is, you see a mirage in the distance. You see a road, you know, an asphalt all the way like kilometers and kilometers. And because it's hot, the air is playing tricks and it looks like there is water in the distance. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
This also happens in the desert. Mm-hmm. So animals who don't know better, who are thirsty, will chase that mirage. And chase it and chase it and chase it and chase it until whatever energy they have is gone. And they fall down dead, right? I have been to Arizona, which is a great desert in the US, and have seen many bones of many animals who have unfortunately been impacted by this Mriga Trishna, by seeing some mirage and dying of dehydration, okay? So, the souls in the material world, all of us here in this room, right? And all of us who are not in this room as well, are referred to as those mrigas. We are looking for quenching of our thirst in this material world. But that thirst cannot be quenched in this material world. It cannot be quenched in a material way. The more we feed the senses gratification, the more the fire of sense gratification burns. It's like adding fuel to the fire. Has anybody put out a fire by adding more fuel to it? You have to deprive fuel, you have to deprive oxygen. That's how you get rid of a fire, right? But Mrigatrishna, when you feed fuel into the senses, fire of the senses, you increase the fire. You increase, and eventually you drop down dead. Anyways, right? That's what happens to people in the material world. So, what this verse is saying is, if someone is free of such a thirst, which is our spiritual master, all these people who are, we just talked about, who are manifesting Vaishnava compassion. If you learn knowledge taught by such a person, then you will also be free of such a thirst. Because it's not only those great souls who have taken this compassion, and only they have this compassion, but they have passed it down in disciplic succession. So all of our spiritual masters actually have access to that kind of knowledge. It's passed down in upagiyamana. It comes in disciplic succession, and it is bhavaushadhi. Bhava means repeated birth and death. Bhava. It means getting born, getting Krishna says, jatasya dhruva murtyur dhruva janma mritasya cha. Krishna says that a person who is born must die, and a person who has died must take birth again. Jatasya dhruva janma mritasya cha. Right? It is inevitable. So persons, if you can find a medicine to prevent this birth and death, that medicine is the medicine that is coming from this disciplic succession. And the compassion means to feed ourselves that medication regularly, to hear from the Vedic scriptures regularly. So this is compassion. Because a person who starts hearing this kind of message that is coming from the disciplic succession finds that it's very pleasing to the heart. You know, when we hear about the spiritual world, when we hear about Krishna's treatment of Putana, when we hear about Krishna's treatment of Shrutadeva or Bahulashva, like when we see Krishna's treatment of all these various personalities, it's very pleasing to see the quality and the standard of Krishna's character. It's just incredible. We cannot find any such person in this material universe, right? Except people who are following Krishna, right? Some of them that we mentioned here. When we discuss these qualities, it's pleasing to the heart, and that is the medicine for the bhava aushadhi, the bhava roga. But there are persons who will leave such a thing aside. All of us are in that category, to be honest, to some degree or the other. We read the scripture, and finally we put the scripture away. Right? But some of them are more acute than others. So, this is called a butcher, vina pashugnat, a person who is accustomed to kill animals. But Srila Prabhupada gives a very amazing, I was just hearing a lecture by Srila Prabhupada recently, where he says somebody wanted to write an article in the Back to Godhead magazine, and they wanted to make propaganda against the profession of butchery. Srila Prabhupada said, why should we make propaganda against a particular class of living entities? There is no need to do that. Because he says, why do the butchers exist? Because the rest of society is buying their products. So who are we going to make a propaganda against? Right? The whole, like, so therefore we have to engage and increase an attraction towards Sri Krishna in everybody's heart, so that they will lose the taste for this. Then there'll be no demand for butchery products. There'll be no butchers. Right? No need to make propaganda against them. What is there wrong? They're just trying to earn a livelihood. And that's the only thing that they can do. Right? Unfortunately. So, but all of us, Srila Prabhupada says, are butchers in this society. Because we are killing our own souls. We are here. We know that there is no taste. We have experienced many times. We have lived decades. Right? Most of the people in this room, some of them are less experienced, but some of them have experience of decades of trying to do this and not finding any satisfaction. And yet we continue to do that. The same thing. So Srila Prabhupada says, we are that person. But if we don't want to be that person, but we know that we are that person today, then we start by right here, coming to ISKCON Scarborough regularly. We have many programs going on, and hearing and chanting about Hare Krishna. Okay? So, if we follow the process given by Srila Prabhupada, read Srila Prabhupada's books, chant Hare Krishna, give ourselves, feed ourselves this medicine that will free us from this cycle of birth and death, then we will be happy. I would like to end actually with a, we started off with a translation. I'd like to read a very famous verse that everybody knows. Okay, please turn to page number in your hardcover Bhagavad Gita's. Please turn to page number 220, verse number 34 from chapter 4. Chapter 4, verse 34. 434. Okay. Chapter 4. Page number 220. Okay. We will repeat the verse and the translation, and we will read the purport together. But in the reading the purport, everybody will read it to themselves while I read it aloud. It can get a little bit confusing. Okay? Okay, together. Tadvidhi pranipatena,
tadvidhi pranipatena,
pariprashnena sevaya,
pariprashnena sevaya,
upadekshanti te jnanam,
upadekshanti te jnanam,
jnaninastatva darshinaha,
jnaninastatva darshinaha.
Just try to learn the truth.
Just try to learn the truth.
By approaching a spiritual master.
By approaching a spiritual master.
Inquire from him submissively.
Inquire from him submissively.
And render service unto him.
And render service unto him.
The self-realized soul.
Self-realized soul.
Can impart knowledge unto you.
Can impart knowledge unto you.
Because he has seen the truth.
Because he has seen the truth.
Everybody asks questions. But rarely anybody asks questions submissively. If this question is not submissive, then the answer that is received will not touch our heart. And if the person perceives that this person is not fit to hear the answer that to this particular question that they have asked, then they will not be inclined to give us the answer. They are in possession of a great treasure. And by asking a question, we are asking them to take that treasure from their hearts and transfer it to our hearts. If you have a great treasure, let's say you have $1 billion, will you just give it to anybody?
No.
You will try to find someone that you think will use that $1 billion properly, isn't it?
Yeah.
Exactly. So that's how a spiritual master is. They have much more than $1 billion. So if we are not submissive with the spiritual master or anybody acting in the role of a spiritual master, why should they give that knowledge to us? They won't feel inspired to do so. Krishna from the heart will not tell them to give us the highest. Yeah? So the spiritual master is giving the highest knowledge to a person they see as actually ready for it. So this is a purport. I'll read the purport. Please follow along in your respective modes of text. The path of spiritual realization is undoubtedly difficult. Not easy, difficult. The Lord therefore advises us to approach a bona fide spiritual master in the line of disciplic succession from the Lord himself. There are all kinds of bearded Indian men, especially, who claim to be gurus, who are not in disciplic succession from the Lord. Run from them. Don't walk, run. Okay? No one can be a bona fide spiritual master without following this principle of disciplic succession. Even in places like Vrindavan, there are people who claim to be self-manifested acharyas. Run from them. Don't stick around. The Lord is the original spiritual master, and a person in the disciplic succession can convey the message of the Lord as it is to his disciple. No one can be spiritually realized by manufacturing his own process, as is the fashion of the foolish pretenders. The Bhagavatam 6.3.19 says, this is Yamraj speaking, so we better pay attention to this statement. Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam. The path of religion is directly enunciated by the Lord. He goes on to say, Navai vidur rishayo napi deva na siddha mukhya asura manushya kutonu vidyadhara charanade. He says, no matter how learned somebody might be, how great somebody might be, how amazing somebody might be, they cannot invent the principles of religion, because the principles of religion are given by God himself. Unless somebody is following God, there's no principle of religion, no matter how smart and how amazing they might appear to be. Okay? The path of religion is directly enunciated by the Lord. Therefore, mental speculation or dry arguments. In other words, if there's a discussion and the question and answer and you receive an answer in disciplic succession, you must implement that answer. Otherwise, don't ask questions. Right? Cannot help lead one to the right path. Nor by independent study of books or knowledge can one progress in spiritual life. People think that ChatGPT or some other kind of AI is going to help them understand the scripture. Sorry, it's not. Right? Just as the book cannot, something derived from the book cannot either. Right? You need a soul connected to the Lord in order to impart spiritual knowledge. One has to approach a bona fide spiritual master to receive the knowledge. Such a spiritual master, please note, should be accepted in full surrender, and one should serve the spiritual master like a menial servant without false prestige. Satisfaction of the self-realized spiritual master is the secret of advancement in spiritual life. Yastadeva tatha prakashante mahatmana. I forget the exact at this very moment. Inquiries and submission constitute the proper combination for spiritual understanding. Unless there is submission and service, inquiries from the learned spiritual master will not be effective. One must be able to pass the test of the spiritual master, and every time the spiritual master interacts with us, they are testing us in so many different ways that we don't even know, you know. And when he sees the genuine desire of the disciple, he automatically blesses the disciple with genuine spiritual understanding. In this verse, both blind following and absurd inquiries are condemned. We get a lot of those. Not only should one hear submissively from the spiritual master, but one must also get a clear understanding from him in submission and service and inquiries. A bona fide spiritual master is by nature very kind toward the disciple. Therefore, when the student is submissive and always ready to render service, the reciprocation of knowledge and inquiries becomes perfect. So if we want to be compassionate to ourselves, tadvirdhi pranipatena, pariprashnena sevaya, upadeshatite jnanam, jnaninas tattvadarshinah. I'll stop here and see if there are questions, comments, or any kinds of clarifications or corrections. There are many elders here as well. You had a question, also Prabhu there in the back had a question.
You already answered it in your lecture.
Answered, thank you very much.
So, compassion is needed, but what about compassion? Like, you categorize compassion, right? So, what about that compassion where, you know, we have seen these incidents, I'm going to take care of the sick, but then they have to convert? Is that compassion?
That's charity in the mode of passion. दातव्यम् इति यद् दानं दीयते अनुपकारिणे देशे काले च पात्रे च तद् दानं सात्विकं स्मृतम्. When a person is given charity without any expectation of return, दातव्यम् इति यद् दानं, because it should be given, therefore I am giving it. अनुपकारिणे, without any expectation of any return, I don't want my name on anything, I don't want my thing, I'm just giving a charity, right? देशे काले च पात्रे च, person in the right country, that means in the temple, for example, or such a sacred place like that. Kale, right time. Patre, a person who is deserving to receive such charity. Taddanam sattvikam sutam. And then Krishna describes the following verses that says that when someone wants pratyupakarartham yaddanam, taddanam rajasam sutam. And then charity in the mode of ignorance, without considering time, place, circumstance, without considering all of these things, that is charity in the mode of ignorance. So when someone is giving charity with the expectation of something in return, that is charity in the mode of passion. It's not transcendental.
Just to draw the boundary, when we go out for, say, book distribution, and when we are trying to motivate somebody to take a book or to chant,
yeah,
how is that not in the same lines?
Because we don't want anything from them. We want whatever it is that we are asking them to do for their sake. Like when I chant Hare Krishna on the street with somebody, I'm not looking for something for myself. I'm looking for that person to chant the names of God at least once in their life, or twice or thrice, so that they will be benefited. Now, a person who is fortunate will do it. A person who is unfortunate will not do it, but we don't change our behavior towards them because they did not do it. We don't change our behavior towards someone who took a Bhagavad Gita and gave us 25 cents. Especially when we first said, give me any donation. Devotees in their immaturity in the past have done it and they might still do it. But that is a mistake. That's a genuine mistake. Right? It's not the principle of our parampara is not like that. Okay? Sometimes if I cannot afford to give a Bhagavad Gita for free, for example, I will say it costs me $10. Anything above $10 or $15 for the hardcore version. Now it's getting more and more expensive. If you give anything more above $15, that's a donation. Somebody might give me exactly $15, or somebody might give me $100. In fact, one lady once gave me like $500 from the ATM. Right? It happened so many times, like at different times. Right? So, do I treat that lady differently? Do I now take her to my home? No. The person who gave 25 cents and the person who gave $500, I'm not changing my behavior towards them in the temple, right? I don't treat a big donor differently. I don't treat Bhaktivinoda Swami Maharaj especially is very insistent about this. It's like, I don't treat a guru or a GBC differently from another devotee. If there are two devotees, you serve both of them prasadam. Not that you serve the guru and the GBC and this person has to wait for 3 hours. No, right? So makes sense? That is our principle. Now in practice, I might not be mature enough to follow the principles properly, but that doesn't mean that my system is bad. It means my understanding of the system is bad. Make sense?
Yes.
Do we have any other questions? Prabhu, Prabhu had a thing from before. No, focus on the specific thing. Daya Bhuteshu is what we spoke about. We don't have time to get into all of the 26 qualities right now. Focus on Daya Bhuteshu. Yes. It's very important to help each other, but it's very important to help each other versus hurt each other. You might think that you are helping a sick person by giving them good food, but you might be hurting them. So that is a very crude example. No, you can't ask him. You can't ask him. Because people don't know what is good for themselves. That's why they are not initiated. That's why they are not chanting 16 rounds. That's why they are not following the regulative principles.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna. Mataji.
Yes, Hare Krishna. Thank you for the nice talk, Mahabhagavat Prabhu. So very, lots of interesting pearls of knowledge. So from 16.1, the first word that is mentioned is abhayam. Fearlessness. So can you, I know we're focusing on compassion, but can you elaborate a little bit, why is fearlessness the first quality which is mentioned?
Yes, because when someone has surrendered to the Lord, which is actually a prerequisite for the other qualities to manifest, a person who is not already surrendered to the Lord 100% cannot manifest any of these. Right? So in fact, there's a verse in the Bhagavatam that says this, which says that, kuto mahatguna, like manorathena sati dhavato bahi, someone who is running after the dictates of their own mind, where will any good qualities be manifested in them? Even though they may be apparently be there, like someone might apparently look very intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
But if they are just a servant of their mind, where is the intelligence? Mm-hmm. Right? So, what is that verse? What is the start of that verse? Huh? Where good qualities are automatically manifest in someone who is, it's not coming to me, but it will come soon. So when it it'll come soon. So in fact, that is a fundamental principle. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam saranam vraja is a fundamental principle. But because we are very crooked, Krishna has to explain it to us in so many different ways.
Yeah.
So that we can come. So Srila Prabhupada says that philosophy is actually not required. For the simple person, you just tell them, chant Hare Krishna, they might start chanting 64 rounds, you know, suddenly. But to the person who is crooked, you have to explain to them, you know, the whole thing about what is in it for you by chanting Hare Krishna. Until they come to the point of pleasing Krishna, we have to tell them why Hare Krishna, why you have to chant, and give them a million reasons. I mean, I'm in the same category. It took me a long time to start chanting.
So one reflection I had is that when you start something new, especially like chanting or book distribution or anything, you initially have fear, right?
Oh, yes.
So you have to get over that fear before...
It will come automatically. If you are, so the whole idea is that we are surrendered to the Lord, then even if there might be fear in the heart, we will act as if there is no fear. The Lord will give us the word, the Lord will give us the nature, the everything. From inside, and so
it's like
all
a prerequisite then
is to be surrendered and know, like Amal Bhakta Swami Maharaj, who is in his, you know, close to his 90s, he's a sannyasi in the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. He's based in New Dwarka, Los Angeles. He used to be a Mayavadi sannyasi, and we have just 1 minute, so we'll complete this. And he then surrendered and became a brahmachari of Srila Prabhupada. At an advanced age, in his 40s, right? And then he remained a brahmachari, and he has, for example, he has recited all of Srila Prabhupada's works in an artistic form, like translation by Amal Bhakta, you'll find, you know, in the internet or anywhere. You can also purchase this from the BBT. So from ISKCON, New Dwarka at least, you can purchase them. And he, whenever he's giving class, for example, he has a picture of Radha Krishna on his, like how I have the Bhagavad Gita here, he has a picture of Radha Krishna. And he's saying outside of the mic, yes, for you, I'm doing this for you. Not for me, not for anybody else. I'm doing this for you. So I hope you like what I'm doing. Like he literally says that to Radha Krishna every time he does that. And he's such a very amazing personality. Like, you know, he will taste prasadam and his diet is so simple. I mean, he's in his, close to his 90s. So his diet is so simple, he eats chapatis and boiled vegetables with salt and no pepper even, right? And he puts one morsel in his mouth and says, Krishna, what have you put into this prasadam today?
Right?
Why is it so delicious, even more delicious than ever before? And here, the devotees in ISKCON Scarborough will make a 16-item feast and he'll say, the sweet was a little too sweet. But really, that's what. But he's really doing it. He's tasting the prasad for Krishna's sake.
Mm.
Right? So, like, he's like, you know, like, he's devotees or something else. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Vancha kalpataru bhischa kripa sindhu bhischa palitanam bhavna ubyo vaishka bhischa namo namaha.
Purusha
Sadhari Sanatana Prasadhe Sadhari Sanatana Prasadhe